A meditation on our scriptures for this Sunday, the third Sunday of Easter, is titled Walking with Jesus. In these days of sheltering in place, we find ourselves living between two destinations. Behind us are our memories of what life was like before the existence of COVID-19. And ahead of us is the day that we pray will come soon, when a preventative vaccine can be developed. Even now, we find ourselves peering into the distance, seeking the next mile marker on this pandemic journey. As we anticipate the lifting of restrictions, we wonder, what will our public life look like in the next phase? So it is, we find ourselves between two destinations, life as it used to be, and life yet to unfold in a new reality. In this season of the 50 days of Easter, our scriptures tell of encounters had by ordinary people, just like us, with the risen Christ. And these are stories that invite us first into the darkness of the empty tomb, and then they turn to welcome us into the joy of resurrection life. Brother Luke tells of two travelers. One is the disciple Cleopas, and the other is unnamed. A masterful storyteller, this may just be Luke's way of inviting you and me to place ourselves in this story, to see ourselves as the other follower of Jesus. What we hear is a tale of transition. One that takes place on the road from one place to another. The story's setting is significant, for these followers are neither in Jerusalem nor have they arrived at their destination in Emmaus. Being neither here nor there, they're in that liminal place where we find ourselves now, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Indeed, throughout our lives, we move from one set of circumstances to another, one phase of life to the next, one way of being for another. We leave one home for the next, graduate from a time of study to a vocation. We move from being a son or daughter to take on the joyful responsibility of many additional roles as aunt, uncle, spouse, parent, or grandparent. With every life change comes a time of transition. And whether change comes to us in ways small or large, the process of living our way into the mystery of dying to one way of being and rising to yet another is repeated. Remembering the way things were, we may find ourselves grieving what we've left behind in order to embrace a new future. And in between the two is this tunnel of transition, this road from one place to another. We are plunged into a kind of holy dying to what was before entering a place of new life. Times of transition are times we feel unmoored from what is familiar. And today's story is just what we need to hear. For it reminds us to trust that our Savior Jesus is a present, active, and creative companion in our lives when we find ourselves on the road, having left one place for another. It takes time to move from doubt to trust, from grief to calm, from uncertainty to hope. The same kind of time it takes to walk from one town to another on an open, dusty road. And the thing is, journeying is our opportunity to be thoughtful, to invest time with one another in open and honest, caring conversation. Isn't this what we long to find in church? Can we as a church family be a place where this can happen? a place where we give one another time to mull over what we're experiencing, where we can talk over what's happened to us in the light of a questioning faith, where we can be honest with one another about our failures and our disappointments and our griefs, where we sense the grace and the patience to bear and explore one another's questions. If so, we'll need to start by creating room to voice what may be the three most poignant words in Scripture or in our lives. We had hoped. We carry in our hearts our longings for our lives. We had hoped our spouse would be healed, our child would recover from addiction, that this job would last, the cancer would go into remission, our strained relationship would be renewed, our church could take steps toward an envisioned future. We had hoped. We have these longings for our personal lives. And we also hold longings for the larger culture in which we live. We had hoped our children would embrace the faith as we did. We had hoped the larger church would be a voice for justice and peace in the world. We had hoped that the fruits of both our neighbors and our own faith, whether Christian, Muslim, Jewish, Hindu, would not be fear nor terror, but love and mercy and compassion. And now we hope for enough protective gear, for adequate supply chains, good health for agricultural workers, for plenty of ventilators and effective treatments. We hope for lives to be preserved. Our story tells of disciples who spoke similarly. We had hoped he was the one to redeem Israel. Oh, these are the landmarks you find on the road to Emmaus, 7 miles of hopelessness leading to dead-end despair. How many times in life have you walked this road? Few things are more painful than dashed hopes. But what we see in our story is that before Jesus interprets Scripture, before he breaks bread, he does two important things. He comes alongside these forlorn disciples, and he asks them to name their loss. And we can do the same as we care for one another and as we care for our neighbors. Before we talk, before we explain, before we invite, we can come alongside and listen. When we experience great loss, there are any number of ways we try to cope. We might try to numb our pain with medication or distract ourselves by hyper-responsibly tending the needs of others, by studying, by working. But I've noticed that paradoxically, when I've taken time to move toward my grief instead of running from it, when I've named my feelings of loss and sorrow and emptiness before God in prayer, that my grief eases. Not that it ever goes away, but it eases enough for me to function and even experience some joy. And when I can share my story, my feelings with a trusted listener, one who prays for me, with me, I've experienced even greater healing. Has this been true for you? Naming our pain, our grief, our loss is an essential step in moving beyond them, not in erasing them or ever leaving them fully behind, but folding them into our lives with God's healing care. It's remarkable how our losses, our mistakes, even our failures can be composted with God's help in ways that enriches the soil of our renewed lives. This is the marvelous gift of God's forgiving grace. Naming our pain creates room for for us to be surprised. The two disciples describe with such longing their crushed hopes. Oh, we had so hoped that this Jesus was the one to redeem Israel. These followers are disappointed in part because they misunderstood how God was working to redeem not just Israel, but to redeem the whole world, expecting a God of power. Instead, they got one of vulnerability. Expecting a warrior God, they got a suffering servant. Jesus acknowledges the painful grief they suffer. So while the disciples may be disappointed because they misunderstand God's work, their pain and their grief are real. And the first thing Jesus does is invite them to name it so that there is now room to be surprised by God's decision to show up just where they least expect God to be. And this still happens for us. When we name our grief and our pain and our disappointment and our fears in the safety of the community of faith and with the assurance of grace, we find space to be surprised by God's presence and love and promise of new life. Where are you today on the Emmaus Road? What life situations, what circumstances are you grieving or fearing or coping with? Take a moment now to name them. Take time to share them with a trusted friend or a loved one. And as you lift these in your prayers, can you trust that Jesus is walking beside you on this path? That he longs to hear all that is on your heart? Can you open yourself to the possibility that God's promise of grace and forgiveness and welcoming love, that God's playful creativity can make room for a new reality, for something unexpectedly beautiful? We're all walking this road, aren't we? Sometimes we may only need to walk 7 miles. Other times it may feel like it's more like 70 or 700. Whatever the distance, Jesus walks with you, along with those of your family of faith. You do not walk alone. And on this road, you can bring your hopes, whether they are dashed or still growing, and your questions, knowing that all of these will be welcomed and cherished. We lift our hearts in prayer. Holy God, you have given us your Son to be our Savior, who comes alongside to walk with us, who calls us out of all our empty tombs, who makes possible our destination of resurrection life. Give us grace this week to listen to our neighbors and to share the good news of the near presence of the risen Christ, who brings eternal hope. Amen.